the benefit of Charlie as an instructor is you've got to be a good storyteller. And with that, you have to know, but not say overtly, what the theme is, where you're going to take your listeners, and tell them, and then take them there, and then tell them why you've taken them there. The thing that grabbed your attention first were the walls, with all of the photos and the fencing memorabilia that he had. The fencing racks with foils on them, foil sabers and épées, behind which were these pictures that would take you back 100 years or more.
In 1966, a young fencing teacher named Charles Selberg was hired at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Charlie was an extremely popular instructor. His classes and weekend workshops were well attended. His students were drawn to his dynamic personality, the passion with which he taught, and his endless stories of fencing and fencers. After retiring from Santa Cruz, Charlie and his wife Julie moved to a wooded valley just north of the California-Oregon border, where Charlie created a fencing studio.
I had to clean this place up and scrape the grease and oil off the floor, painted it, and I thought that I'd take all of this memorabilia that I've collected for over 35 years and put it up so I could see it all at one time.
It was always a delight, because like any mosaic, anytime you go to it, you find something new or you rediscover something you knew before.
It's amazing that George Pillar's picture pops up over and over.
And up here we have George Pillar, another one of the great fencers of all time.
Then there were pictures of this very tall, slim, elegant-looking mustachioed man in a uniform with medals on his chest. And another picture of a fencing master picture with his mask and his foil.
He won two world championships and the 1932 Olympics back-to-back. Ever achieved that? This was taken in 1932 when he won the 1932 Olympics in Los Angeles. And I was rummaging around all of my old archives and I found this ticket, which is the ticket to the 1932 Olympics. How's that?
Charlie kept alive the memories of many famous fencers, but foremost among them were tales of his famous teacher, George Pillar. Charlie knew a great deal about Pillar's life and history, and imprinted those stories onto his students. But many details of Pillar's life were unknown to Charlie, who knew his revered fencing master for just a brief period.
One day in 1956, I learned about George Pillar when Jack Baker, the secretary of the Amateur Fencers League of America, told me that he was coming and explained that he was an absolutely wonderful fencing master. We heard the story about his many, many victories starting in 1930, and we were just blown away.
In light of Charlie's many tales, it seemed there must be more to the story of George Pillar's life. What happened at the 1932 Olympics? How did he escape Russian captivity at the end of World War II? Were the Hungarian saber fencers truly unbeatable? And why did Charlie refer to Pillar as the last captain?
Jekelfalussy, vagy Pillar, ugye korábbi nevén Alezredes, egy nagyon-nagyon érdekes alakja a magyar hadtörténelemnek, meg a sporttörténelemnek, és nyilván, de nekem nyilván a hadtörténelmi oldalról kellett eddig is, és ezután is beszélnem.
He's a two-times Olympic champion in 1932 Los Angeles.
Négy olimpiára vitte ki a magyar csapatot. Ez már Berlinben is itt volt. Berlinben, Londonban, Helsinkiben, és végül Melbourneben is ő volt a magyar vívó csapat kapitánya. Ahonnan is nem jött haza.
George Pillar was an individual you would remember even if he didn't fence.
He exuded confidence and respect.
Hát ő bálványa volt minden nőnek, a magas alakja, meg a neve, meg a olimpia, a sport. Meg.
When he entered the room, he carried the weight.
Somebody facing him almost was like facing a cavalry charge.
They said that Pillar could have won a championship using a pencil.
És az a típusú ember volt, aki a tréning ruhában is a katonatiszt volt.
You know, even though I never met Pillar, his fencing is part of the DNA of how I teach fencing.
I'm not a hero worshiper really, but if I was going to worship a hero, that would be the one.
He told me Pillar is greater than me. Wow, so that caught my interest. He never said that about anyone. No one. Not even God.
The story of George Piller's life begins here, at his childhood home in Eger, Hungary, today adorned with a plaque dedicated to the memory of his Olympic victory.
Ugye, ő 1899-ben született egy több gyermekes családban. Az ő katonai pályafutása Pécset kezdődött egy úgynevezett hadapród iskolában.
Tehát itt 14 éves korba kerülnek be fiatalok az intézménybe, és négy évet tanulnak, és utána vatják őket föl tiszté. Tehát gyakorlatilag Piller már 10 éves korában megismerkedett.
Ennek tulajdonképpen az volt a magyarázata, vagy az is, a testnevelésen és a sporton kívül, hogy párbajképesnek az az ember számított, aki érettségizett. Éppen ez magyarázza egyébként a nagy számban a zsidó származású sportolók jelenlétét a vívók között, hiszen őket gyakrabban provokálták, és ők nagyobb számban is voltak a középiskolások között.
Tehát itt az volt a cél, hogy a fronton mielőbb jól kiképzett katonák kerüljenek ki.
Adott volt, hogy sportoló lesz, ezt ő észrevette, Budapestre járt fel Egerből, mert ott lett katona, atlétikai versenyekre, remekül birkózott az elejénél fogva is, sőt még boxolt is, és sőt még tornázni is kicsi elkezdett. Tehát sport szenvedélyes ember volt.
He himself graduated at this cadet school in 1917.
He did well in the military academy.
His older brother was killed in action at an early stage in the First World War. He was very shocked and saddened about the hero's death of his older brother.
Egerben nőtt fel. Eger városa, az a hősök városa, az 16. századbeli török invázió miatt, ahol az egyetlen magyar vár, aki meg tudta védeni magát. Ő ott nőtt fel. Ezt a hősieséget gyerekkorában magába szívta.
1917-ben megnyerte az év folyamának a kardvívó bajnokságát, úgyhogy ő már itt találkozott a vívással.
The saber is an important national symbol because fighting against the Ottoman troops was done by the hand and by the saber.
Amikor elvégezte ezt a hadapród iskolát, a háború végén került ki még az arcunk.
Az első világháborúban rohamista volt. A rohamista az a 20-25 emberből álló alakulat, aki kiúrik a lövészárokból, megtesz néhány száz métert az ellenfél lövészárkáig, ösztűzben, mindenki próbálja őt lelőni, mert tudják, hogy közben őt majd jön a fogókkal és átvágja a szöges drótot, és dobálja közben a kézigránátot. Általában 25 rohamistából 10 ért oda az ellenfélig. Gondoljon bele, hogy milyen bátorság az, hogy a Jekelfalussy Piller György rohamista kiképzést kapott. Eleve az első világháborúban.
Úgy gondolta, hogy katonaként szolgálja leginkább a hazáját, és...
The three different disciplines in fencing is called foil, épée, and saber. The one that I fence is saber. In track and field, you have the 100 meters, the 200 meters, the 400 meters, the marathon. The saber would be the 100 meters. The épée fencers are more cerebral. The foil fencers and épée, they think a little more. The saber fencers, not that they don't think, but they're more big mouths, they're more gregarious, they're more outspoken.
Miskolcra járt vívni, ott tanult vívni a Gerevics papánál, ugye akinek két fia volt, és kiváló vívó lett a Gerevics Haladár világhíró, 6 olimpiai bajnokságot nyert, meg ilyesmit.
He wanted to prove to the parents and himself that he's going to be a simple boy from Eger doing well in the big city of Budapest.
He did excel in several sports like football, wrestling, boxing.
1925-ben alapítják meg a Magyar Királyi Honvéd Toldi Miklós Sportanár és Vívómester Képző Intézetet Magyarországon, ami arra hivatott a továbbiakban, hogy a testnevelést a tisztek és a katonák számára magasabb szintre hozza, és olyan embereket, olyan tiszteket, altiszteket képezzen, akik aztán a testnevelést, a testnevelés különböző ágait és a sport különböző ágait be tudják vinni a haderőben, minél mélyebben. Ő ekkor elkezdi ezt a tanfolyamot 1925-ben, 27-ig, két éves ez a tanfolyam, és tulajdonképpen itt kezd el karddal vívni. Ő korábban törvívást is gyakorolt, sőt, később is abban is szerzett érdemeket, de a kardvívás igazából itt lett a sajátja.
És tulajdonképpen viszonylag idősen került be a sport élvonalában, már az első világháború után. Ő a 30-as évek elejére a legjobb magyar vívó lett.
Piller's prowess in Saber and his ability to compete at an international level was the culmination of two fencing traditions that developed in Hungary before the turn of the 20th century. One was best exemplified by the Toldi Miklós instructor László Borsodi, the other by an Italian fencing master living in Budapest named Italo Santelli.
Hát az egyik leghíresebb magyar kardiskola volt, úgyhogy elismerten két nagy ága volt a magyar kardvívásnak, a Borsodi iskola és a Santelli, olasz Santelli mester.
International fencing competitions began to emerge in the late 1800s. Highlighted by the inclusion of fencing at the first modern Olympics in Athens, Greece in 1896.
Amikor az első olimpiára Athénbe 1896-ba nem mentek ki a magyar vívók, mert egy olasz magyar millenniumi emlékversenyt rendeztek, ahol
saber fencing methodology advanced most significantly in two countries, Italy and Hungary, to prove to the world their domination in fencing. The Hungarians, in 1896, organized a rival competition to the Olympic Games, inviting the best fencers and masters, including the Italians.
De mindenki biztos volt benne, hogy az olaszokat le fogják győzni, és a magyar kard, a magyar virtus diadalmaskodni fog. Na most...
Ő megnyerte a millenniumi kardversenyt, tehát ezt a bizonyos versenyt, ahol kiderült, hogy a magyar kard mégse a legjobb a világon.
Minden számban az olaszok nyertek.
Santellit leszerződtették, itt maradt, és ő ötvözte a magyar kardvívó stílust a akkor modernnek számító olaszsal.
Extraordinary, invited this Italian coach teach the major club.
Santelli's contributions went beyond the standard teaching methodology of the times. His fencers used footwork speed and mobility to a degree unseen before. Even more important, Santelli took advantage of the new style of sport saber blades, which were lighter and more flexible. He taught his fencers to manipulate the weapon with tiny movements of wrists and fingers, rather than the common practice of bending the elbow to make a cut, a practice no longer required but still commonly taught. Another development of Santelli's was a counterattack, the stop cut.
So Italo literally invented the stop cut. And he said there's an interval between the time the man starts his attack, even if it's a direct attack, and the time that you receive the attack, when you can get a cut in.
The Santelli type of people went more for the speed, looseness, and a little sloppiness, and not so much of a strategy as the Borsodi Piller people. We fenced a little slower, but we knew what we're doing that much more.
Volt ugye az olaszok képviselőként a Santelli, aki olimpiai bajnok, tehát a legnagyobb bajnokok Santellinél voltak, Kárpáti, Gerevics, tehát egyszerűen és hát Törbe is.
Borsodi volt az, aki elsősorban a katonatiszteket, tehát a katonatiszt vívókat trenírozta, illetve.
Piller was the perfect vehicle for Borsodi's coaching genius. Together, they studied both Piller's forerunners and his contemporaries, and just as Santelli revolutionized offensive technique, Borsodi had an equally important effect on defensive strategies.
He basically promoted what is called in Saber the triangular defense, in other words, terz, quart, and quint, which simplified the motions.
Borsodi wanted to create a new style of Hungarian fencing, and to this end, he stripped out everything extraneous, especially in defense.
Laszlo Borsodi was one of the famous fencing masters of the period. He started around the turn of the last century, and from the 1920s through the 1930s, he was responsible for the success of lots of famous Hungarian fencers.
Borsodi egy új módszert hoz be a kardívásba, és Piller ezt a módszer sorozatot követi, méghozzá úgy, és azért, mert ami újdonság ebben az időben, amit a Borsodi is megtanít az ő katonáival, az ő sportolóival, az a katonai készségek beleágyazása a kardívásba.
He was a very strict person, and he was very much respected by his fencers.
Sometimes get his pupils stripped to the waist and fence, because he felt that way they could get the real sense of fencing coming from a live or die activity.
Én azt gondolom, hogy Borsodi egy nagyon határozott, nagyon felkészült, és a tanítványait szigorúan kezelő vívómester volt, és azt hiszem, hogy ezek később Piller esetében a saját tevékenységére is nagyon komoly hatást gyakoroltak.
Ugye Borsodi ezt dolgozza ki, és ezt teszi gördülékenyé, egy olyan mozgás sorozattá, és egy olyan megközelítésé, amit Piller kiválóan elsajátít.
He fenced a different style than the Santelli pupils.
Én azt gondolom, hogy meghatározó szerepe lehetett abban, hogy Piller Györgyből olyan vívó lett, amilyen vívó lett, és olimpiai bajnok.
It was a sort of surprising that, in spite of Santelli's dominance, person with a different Borsodi style would do so well.
The students of these two masters often faced one another in Hungarian and international competitions, creating a fierce rivalry.
A Borsodinál azt kell mondanom, hogy többen voltak azok, akik a hivatásos állományban, akik katonaként szolgáltak, hiszen mégis egy katonai intézetben működött, és egy hivatásos vívómester volt, katonai vívómester volt. Santellinél pedig úgymond bárki megjelentetett a civil életből is.
The military club wouldn't take Jews, and that was a big arguing point, because the best Jewish fencers were fencing with Santelli.
Természetesen itt összecsapások voltak.
Igen, hogy ők lementek, mintha tanulni akarnának. Pedig a Borsodi küldte őket azért, hogy leteszteljék a civil vívókat, a kabost, a petcsauért, a gombost.
Én azt gondolom, hogy az a szó, hogy egészséges rivalizálás, az meghatározó lehet erre a két iskolára, és egy gondolok, vagy a két vívómesterre. Hozzátéve azt, hogy nyilván, amikor az egyiknek a tanítványa értek el nagyobb sikert, akkor azt mondták, hogy mi vagyunk a jobbak, lám-lám, a miénket kell folytatni.
És ezért tulajdonképpen az állandó vetélkedés is kitermelte azt az edzésmódszert, amit későbbiek során végül is hasznos volt, de abban az időben nem lehetett egyszerű dolog.
És a történet szerint Piller a Borsodi iskolának a tagja, Gombos pedig a Santellié. És azon megy a dolog itt a vívás, ugye, hogy most a Santelli iskola jobb, vagy a Borsodi iskola. És hogy miként zajlik ez a vívás, ezt még megörökítette a híradó is, de kiderül, nincs pást, meg egyebek, úgyhogy.
Remarkable, eccentric, demanding coaches, each bringing new ideas and all coming at the same time.
The rivalry between these two masters and their students gave rise to a unique Hungarian style of saber fencing, which helped shift competitive supremacy from the Italians to the Hungarians. It began with Hungary's first Olympic participation in 1908. From that beginning, the Hungarians dominated saber fencing for the next 50 years.
I mean, the school of fencing under Italo Santelli was so dominant, it was unbelievable.
And the Hungarians won almost all of the saber events in individual and team in the Olympics.
It wasn't a question whether they win the Olympic Games, the question was, can they come in 1, 2, 3?
Úgyhogy a magyar kardozók olyan jók voltak, hogy egy magyar középdöntő, egy válogató verseny az erősebb volt, mint a világbajnoki döntő.
First results in sports were within the military in the first half of the 1920s. Then he participated at the 1928 Olympic Games in Amsterdam as a member of the foil fencing team. They were fifth at that Olympic Games. It was another military officer who won both the individual and the team gold medal. He was called Eden Terstjanski. who was famous for being a real military officer, for being very modest and for learning to fence with his left hand after he got a bad injury during the First World War in Russian captivity. But then he was killed in a road accident in 1929 in Hungary, and his sword was taken up by Pillar.
Nagyon sokféle, sokszínű vívást tudott produkálni, és ez volt a különlegessége és az eredményességének a titka. Tehát ő fölvette, tehát mindig igazodott az ellenfeles stílusához, és ahhoz igazította a sajátját.
Pillar could not be beaten, and people couldn't figure out what it was he was doing.
Some of the stories about his success to kind of poo-poo it was, oh, he was double jointed in his wrist, and that was the way that he beat everybody.
He was 12 times Hungarian champion in saber fencing, and also several times the champion in foil fencing.
And I remember asking my first national coach, a man called Bob Anderson. I said, what makes a fencer? And he said, well, I think three things: timing, anticipation, and willpower. And I think Pillar had those three gifts to a hugely advanced degree.
Ez a kapcsolat odáig fajult, hogy így mondjam, hogy külön terembe kapott iskolákat, iskoláztak. A borsodi annyira szerette, és annyira kiválónak tartotta, és annyira saját, hogy mondjam, találmányának, hogy így mondjam, tartotta, hogy külön terembe, nem a többiekkel együtt adott neki iskolát, és tanította trükkökre is, és olyan dolgokra, ami más előtt el volt zárva. Tehát abszolút egyedi kiképzést kapott a borsoditól.
At the European Championships in Budapest in 1929, he already won gold medal. He did the same in 1930 in Liège, Belgium, and in 1931 in Vienna. But the top of his career was the Los Angeles Olympics.
He used to tell me some real stories about some of his matches against, mostly about the Italians, okay, because they were the enemy.
Pillar's string of victories reached its high point at the 1932 Olympic Games in Los Angeles, California. He was 33 years old.
1932-ben a Los Angeles-i olimpiára benevezik őt, mint a kardvívó válogatottnak a tagját, illetve egyéniben is elindítják.
Well, what's interesting about the 1932 Olympic Games from a Hungarian perspective is that our delegation had to travel a lot. Sailing across the ocean was quite a long time and quite exhausting.
És hát a hajóút az olyan 5-6 napba telt körülbelül. Hát ott vannak a nagy vívók, ugye a Jekelfalussy, meg a többiek, és hát azok meg, mivel töltik az időt, kártyáznak. Zsuga, kártya. És a többi sportág meg ottan izzad a dekken, ugye a fedélzeten, és tornázik, meg mindent csinálnak, és a tornászok mérgesek lettek, hogy hát mi a fene egye meg ezek a vívók, hát mi szórakoznak, itt állandóan kártyádnak, meg leütik, meg mit tudom én. És akkor az egyik odaszólt neki, hogy hát, Gyurka, hát mit csináltok? Hát edzés, vagy mi van, hogy mi? Azt mondja, mert oda csoportosultak az összesek az asztal köré. És azt mondja, hát ti nem értetek a sporthoz? Hát amit most csinálunk, hát az a legnagyobb felkészülés, ezeket az ideg táncokat, amik itt vannak a sugázásban, hát felkészítjük magunkat lelkileg. Piros ulti durkmas.
In the finals, Pillar had no losses, and another person had no losses, a left-hander. In between them was Scaldini, who had already had one loss. Pillar was sure that he could beat the left-hander, but he did not want to knock himself out fencing Galdini, who was darn near 7 feet tall.
És akkor azt mondta a vívótársaidnak, ne ijedjetek meg, én leadom az asszot, hadd örüljenek, mert azt hiszik, hogy ők nyerik akkor az olimpiai bajnokságot. De én tudom, hogy nekem még van egy asszom, az biztosan megverem, és én leszek.
So he dumped the bout to Galdini. The next bout was for the title, and he said he had observed that this left-hander had a put a backward bend in his blade in the previous bout, and on the first touch did a little glide on the cart side of the other guy's blade and popped it on the arm, on the inside of the arm. And so Piller fixed his blade that way, and the ready fence, pop, he hits him on the arm the same way. So it ruined his first shot, and Piller had a touch beside, and the rest of the bout was just like downhill.
És így is történt. Ő leadta az asszóját, az olasz, azok óriási üdvrivalgás, öröm, stb. Megnyerjük az olimpiát. Viszont mivel az utolsó asszóját megnyerte, ő lett az olimpiai bajnok.
A Los Angeles-i olimpián mind a kard egyénit megnyeri, Jekelfalussy, mind pedig csapatban első helyezést ér el.
Viszont nyilvánvaló egy olyan elismerést jelentett az ő számára, hogy hatalmas tömeg fogadja visszaérkezéskor, beszélhet arról, hogy megtettük, amit megkövetelt a hazai, és így tovább.
Piller György százados úrnak átadom a Honvédség kosarastagának.
Nem tettünk egyebet, mint azt, hogy magyar lélekkel és erős magyar akarással teljesítettük kötelességünket.
Every Olympian has the same similar athletic abilities. Fast, speed, running, timing, pretty similar. But the ones that rise up out of great Olympians are the ones that's able to deal with their fear and deal with their nervous system. And those are the ones that are able to win medals. Piller was that great type of person.
Amikor hazaér az olimpiáról, a katonai pályája is rendfokozatban is változik, és egy nagyon nagy megtiszteltetés éri őt, a testőrség tagjává válik.
He claimed in his CV that he was given this position as a reward for his Olympic success.
És előfordulhat az, hogy volt valaki olyan személy a katonai vezetés tagjai között, aki ajánlotta őt, hogy kerüljön be a testőrségbe. Tehát nem volt egyszerű belépni egyébként a testőrségbe.
It was a very prestigious elite organization. It was the bodyguard of Miklós Horthy, the regent.
De említettem, ő ekkor százados, és egy testőr szakasznak a parancsnoklását kapja meg.
Én azt gondolom, hogy úgy érezték sokan, hogy ez a kétszeres olimpiai bajnok megérdemli azt, hogy a kormányzó környezetében legyen, és a kormányzó is mondhatja azt, hogy kérem, a testőrségemben olyan tisztek szolgálnak. Többen is voltak, akik kitűnő sportolók voltak közülük.
As a member of this most Hungarian and elite troop, he was urged to Hungarianize his name.
It was not expected that he elegantly withdrew, that I did whatever I could do and I don't want to compete again.
Piller's retirement from competition was short-lived. In 1933, Hungary played host to the World Fencing Championships. Due to an error, one of Hungary's best fencers, László Rakszanyi, was left off the official list of competitors for the team event, while Piller's name, listed as team captain, remained.
Margit szigeten volt az Európa bajnokság, akkor Piller már visszavonult, már nem vívott, és az olaszokkal vívtuk a döntőt.
A Rajcsányit akarta a magyar csapat vivatni, és az olaszok látják, hogy a Rajcsányi bemelegít, és mennek a magyarok vezetőjéhez, hogy hát mit akar a Rajcsányi, hát ő nincs föl a liftán. Amit nekünk küldtetek, ott azon a névsoron nincs. De, mint a csapatkapitány, a Jekelfalussy véletlenül rajta volt, de őt nem is akarták vivatni, mert ő már visszalépett, ő nem vív többet. Ez egy évre rá volt, már nem is igen edzett, nem is érezte jó magát, de az olaszok azt mondták, visszaléptünk, mert nem fogadjuk el a Rajcsányit.
Az egyik magasrangú vezetőnk, Gömbös Gyula, írt egy levelet a Pillernek, aki otthon 42 fokos lázzal szenvedett, hogy Gyurka, gyere, mert baj van. Piller 5 perccel a nevezés lejárta előtt odaért.
Erre fölrohantak vívóruhát szerezni a Jekelfalussynak, meg sisakot, meg kardot, meg nem tudom mit, és majdnem bemelegítés nélkül hívták a versenyzőket föl a bemutatásra, és akkor megjelenik a Piller a kapott cuccba, de rajta van, mint mindig, a testőr katonai köpeny.
5000 ember remegett, hogy most lesz magyar-olasz döntő, vagy nem. És amikor már a másodperceket mutatta az óra, akkor egyszer csak levette ezt a köpenyt magáról, és ott volt alatta a vívóról. Az újságírók írták, hogy amikor fölállt küzdeni, az egész keze és teste remegett. A kard is remegett a kezébe a láztól.
És az első asszúja pontosan ebben az olimpia második helyezett olasz Marcival van. Az meg ugye megtudta, hogy hát csak beugró, hűha nem is vívott edzett, akkor ezt megverem.
És amikor elkezdtek vívni, már 3-0-ra vezetett az olasz, és akkor...
És beszól neki a Baj Béla, hogy mi van, Baka?
És a Baka ugye az a legalsó, a közkatona. Mi van, Baka? Mondta nekem.
Ne szarj be, Béla!
Visszaszólt a Piller, hogy eddig csak megfigyeltem. Most jövök én. 3-0-ról 5-3-ra megnyeri az első mérkőzést, a másodikat 5-1-re, a harmadikat 5-0-ra, és az utolsóra az olasz már föl se jön.
Mert nem akar szégyen szemre, ő is kikapné.
Ezért ő beugróként, mint jogos beugró edzőként beszáll a csapatnak a tevékenységébe, és hát fantasztikus kardívással ugye győzelemre viszi a csapatot.
Ennek örömére Gömbös Gyula az arany cigarettatárcáját adta Piller Györgynek.
Így van ez a történet. Tehát ott adta vissza egy évvel később azt, amit leadott neki Los Angelesben.
In February of 1936, Piller married Ilona Mudin, whose father and uncle had both been Olympians and, like Piller's own father, were killed in World War I. After this final competitive triumph, Piller retained the honorary title of captain for the Hungarian national team, serving partly as coach, but more as an analyst and strategist. When it came to a tactical fight, he was prepared with detailed and exact knowledge of other fencers, their style, techniques, mannerisms, tendencies, and stamina, all the data needed for victory.
And as soon as Piller retired, then the things would get back to normal and the Italians would regain their supremacy seat.
Then when he trains proteges and students, and then they start winning tournament after tournament and medal after medal, then it's like, well, maybe something's going on here.
He trained 7 world championship teams back to back. And they took all the individual medals back to back. The Hungarians could not be beaten.
In 1936, Piller led the Hungarian team to Berlin, and once again they captured the individual and team gold medals in Sabre. Szentelly pupil André Kabos took the individual gold medal. Although no longer fencing, Piller's strategic thinking could still impact the outcome of competitions.
Egy vívóversenyen, egy nemzetközi vívóversenyen, nem Magyarországon, nemzetközi vívóversenyen volt, és ő csapatvezető, és a balkezes Kabos vívott. Kiváló vívó volt, nagyon jó tempóérzéke volt, és balkezes mindig előnyben van, mert általában, és ő támad, és úgy érzi, hogy fejbe vágta az ellenfelet, és lekapta a sisakját, amit nem szabad, az ellenfél meg fejbe verte. Na most a Kabost megbüntették, mivel lekapta asszok közben a sisakját, tehát én nincs. Esetleg ki is állítják, vagy lehet eltiltják. És ott áll a Jekelfalussy, és a Kabos meg fejbe vágja, csak így néz, és az öregnek pillanatokon belül átvillant, hogy mit kell csinálni, hogy meg legyen oldva a dolog. Oda kiabálta a Kabosnak, hogy állj el, ess össze, te marha! És a Kabos összeesett le, stb. Fogta a fejét, és én nem tudom mi. És akkor mindenki elkezdte őt sajnálni. És akkor jöttek orvos, meg bekötni, meg Jézus, oda szaladtak a magyarok, meg minden. Ebben eltelt annyi idő, hogy mire fölállt, a zsűri elnök már el is felejtette, hogy lekapta a sisakot, stb. Úgyhogy se tuss nem ítéltek ellene semmiféle fegyelmi, vagy ilyesmi, stb. Nem, hanem elkezdtek utána vívni, és a Kabos meg többet nem tépte le a sisakját idő előtt.
Toward the end of 1936, Piller's tenure with the Royal Guard came to an end. Upon leaving the Guard, he resumed his duties as a regular military officer and as a military sports instructor.
During the first half of the 1940s, he was an instructor at the military college.
Ez egy tisztképző intézmény volt, ahol a műszaki fegyvernemhez, repülőkhöz, tüzérséghez képezték ki a tiszteket. Ez mondjuk egy ilyen Hungarian West Point volt körülbelül.
In 1944, when the war reached Hungary and Hungary became a battlefield, he was sent to one of the fighting units.
Nem megy ki egészen 1944-ig a frontra, olyan beosztásba, ami tulajdonképpen, úgy mondanák, hogy frontbeosztás, tehát igazi első vonalbeli frontbeosztás.
And he wrote down how he did his best not to take part in a brainless fight for something that was lost already.
Többnyire képzéssel, viszonylag kevesebb közvetlen harci tevékenység éri őt. Majd az ő, ugye a Szent László hadosztály az a mai Ausztria területére vonul vissza 1944 végén, 1945 elején.
Szóval a második világháborúban zászlói parancsnok, tehát alakulatparancsnok, és úgy vonul vissza, hogy a Vörös Hadsereg sem bekeríteni, sem szétverni nem tudja a csapatát. Ausztriáig vonul vissza a Vörös Hadsereg elől a Pillernek az alakulata. Sem bekeríteni nem tudják, sem felmorzsolni. Nem sok zászlói tudott akkoriban ilyesmivel dicsekedni.
But it was a very poorly equipped unit and he also got sick.
Megvan a feleség levele, amiben kéri a parancsnokságot, hogy helyezzék betegállományba, mert beteg a férje, de a férjéről tudja, hogy soha nem fog betegszabadságra menni, amikor harcolni kell a hazájáért.
A szovjet fogságba kerül, és egy újabb, nagyon szerencsés életfordulat következik a katonai pályafutásában. Szent László hadosztály többi része többnyire angol fogságba vonulnak gyakorlatilag, mert ugye ők adják meg magukat. Jánosházán egy átmeneti fogolytáborba kell elhelyezése.
And they put him on a train to go to Siberia.
Ezt követően mikor a marhavagonokba tették fel a magyar honvédtiszteket és honvédeket, akiket vittek Szibériába, Budapesten az állomáson megállt ez a marhavagonokat szállító vonat, és ott a Piller az a marhavagonnak a rácsán levegőt szeretett volna venni, mert nagyon zsúfolva voltak, és ahogy vette a levegőt a rácson keresztül, a Péter Gábor, az ABH későbbi parancsnoka fölismerte, hogy az a Piller az olimpiai bajnok, nekünk az még hasznunkra lehet, vegyétek le a vonaton.
And that's how he didn't have to go to Russian captivity, which was hell on earth.
Jól tudjuk, hogy körülbelül 800,000 embert hurcoltak, és abból 200,000 nem jött haza soha többet. Tehát nem, de ha hazajön, akkor is általában szörnyű állapotban, és hosszú évek után.
There is a very interesting and valuable document from 1948. It's a declaration written by a Jewish person who in this declaration wrote down that they were neighbors with Piller's family. They were in very good relationship even before the war, and that in 1944, when really hard times came for Jewish people living in Hungary, they could give their valuable items to Piller, who took care of them and returned to them after the war. When he was away with the military and their flat was empty, they let these Jewish people use their flat so they could hide from the German authorities. Perhaps important that in the Olympic team there were two Jewish fencers, Attila Pechauer and Endre Kabos.
He always talked very highly about these two fencers, Kabos, who won the Olympics in 36, and Attila Pechauer, who was unfortunately died in a concentration camp.
World War II took a great toll on the Hungarian fencing community. Besides Pechauer's death, 1912 Olympian Oskar Goerde and 1925 World Sabre champion János Garay died in concentration camps. André Kabos, the 1936 gold medalist, died in the explosion of the Margit Bridge, which was accidentally destroyed by a Nazi demolition team. The two famous coaches, Santelli and Borsody, also were victims. Borsody, a Jewish-born convert to Catholicism, took his own life, and Santelli starved to death, apparently in despair over the death of his youngest daughter in an Allied bombing raid. After the war, Hungary experienced great turmoil as governments rose and fell, until finally in 1948, the communists, with Soviet backing, finally consolidated complete control of the nation.
He was way up there before the war, respected nationally in every which way, and he just, like everybody else, wound up in the bottom.
edzett háború után, tehát a szovjet fogságba került, és amikor visszakerült a hadifogságból, a Vasasnál kezdett el vívó mesterként is dolgozni, és a szövetség kapitánya volt, tehát vívó kapitánya volt.
1948-ban fejezi be a katonai pályafutását.
With the new Soviet-style communist government, every facet of society was regulated, no matter how small. Out of the military for the first time in his adult life, Piller had to remake his life as a civilian.
He was an undesirable person.
And if he wouldn't have had at his resume the fact that he was a national hero, being the Olympic champion for Hungary, they would have dealt him very harshly with him.
Baj Béla megpróbálja kommunista rezsimet rábeszélni, hogy a vívás az fontos, kellene támogatni, mert nemzetközileg lehet Magyarországot és a kommunizmust ezzel, mint győztes sportot, a vívást támogatni kellene.
He's the one who approached Piller of let's get started something again.
Az, hogy ő a háború után a Vasasban lett edző, az nyilván köszönhető volt annak, hogy őt, mint a Horthy testőrtisztjét bélistázni akarták, tehát ki akarták szorítani a sportból, illetve hát állásvesztéssel járt volna ez.
De főleg a Vasasba, ott talált ő otthont, és Vasasnak volt az edzője, és ott vívott a nagy magyar vívókkal, mint például a Kovács Pál volt Vasas versenyző.
Tehát Pillerre szüksége volt a magyar sporttársadalomnak, mert a sporttal akarta megmutatni az akkori Magyarország, hogy mi is érünk annyit, mint a nyugatiak.
Először nem sikerül neki, mert a kommunisták inkább a munkás sportokat szeretnék támogatni.
The fencing in Hungary was not very popular during the communist system because it was considered as a bourgeois activity.
Nagy nehezen sikerül Dr. Baj Bélának rábeszélni a vezetést, hogy igenis kezdjék el és engedjék meg a vívást, mint sportot tovább űzni.
Hungary didn't attend the first post-war world championships, but did put together a squad for the 1948 Olympics in London. With Piller at his side, Aladár Gerevich, the old man of the squad at 38 years of age, wins the Olympic individual gold and the team stays true to form, defeating the Italians in the final match for the gold.
Gondolj bele, mit mondasz tanítvány, mesterként a tanítványodnak, amikor felküldöd a pástra? Amikor lehet, hogy ő úgy vív, hogy a te életed is a tét lehet 48-ban. Az edzők életéért is vívtak azok a fiúk 48-ban.
Lack of financial support keeps the Hungarians away for the next two world championships. But in 1951, they returned with nearly the same outcome. Gold in team and Gerevich winning the individual medal. But at home, most Hungarians struggled to find a sense of normalcy under the communist rule.
It was difficult to adapt to a system which was alien to most Hungarians.
In 1948, my father was arrested. Our company was nationalized. In 1948, October, I was arrested. I was in every single jail in Budapest and around, then the detention camp for a half year. Then I came out, I was kicked out of the university.
Life was indescribable. Terror, fear, intimidation.
És van itt még valami, az a légkör, amikor megfigyelnek, lehallgatnak, nyomodban vannak, a családodat ellehetetlenítik, az egy idő után felörli a lelkeket.
Even if you knew that what you are saying is nonsense, you had to make a good face and you had to applaud to it and say it in unison over and over and over again.
Az én családom az egyéb beosztást kapta, ami annyit jelent, hogy el van vágva mindentől. Én lehettem akármilyen jó tanuló, engem nem vettek fel az egyetemre. Én háromszor próbáltam, megvan mind a három vizsgám, és arról a papír a jegyekkel, hogy megfelelt, de férőhely hiányában nem vesznek fel. Tehát nekem nem volt szanszom egyetemre menni tovább tanulni.
Leaders of the party moved into your apartment and owned everything.
We were sleeping in relatives' kitchens and whatnot on the floor and that kind of stuff.
My father couldn't get any job because we were considered to be the enemy of the state. The only job finally he could get to go to the river and kill mosquitoes with DDT.
My father couldn't get a job for years. He started working as a laborer for the gardening company taking care of Budapest.
Then my mother went to work, and she worked in a canning factory. And she had probably the worst possible job because she had to clean paprika, green peppers. So every night she came home, her hand was just red.
Next time the truck came around about 3 weeks later, and this time it was half a dozen trucks, stop at any place, just any place, random, go into the house, man. This is midnight or after midnight, drag out the men of the house usually, drag it on the truck and disappear. Man never came back. And that goes on night after night after night, creating fear, creating terror.
A komoly rendszeres vívást azt éppen, mint mondtam, a Honvédba kezdtem el 49-be, ahol egy Bucskó Jenő alezredes tanított, akit máról holnapra elvitt az államvédelmi hatóság, és így eltűnt. Egyszerűen nem jelent meg az egyik edzésen, és így edző nélkül maradtam.
They took his home, occupied his home. This is no longer your home, this is the country's home.
Tomorrow morning we are here, you can carry two luggage. And we take you to a lousy village, 200 miles, where nobody wants you to come, and you have to live here.
The only place my father could find, because we only had 3 days to go, and it was a winter, snow, two kids, he found an old abandoned shoemaker shop, which nobody would even dream to live in.
Half of the apartment was kind of bombed out, you know, so we didn't have really a bathroom with showers or anything like that.
Vagy pedig, én tudom, mert nálunk sokszor voltak kint rendőrök, és mondták, hogy például az eldugott árut adjuk elő. Édesanyám volt otthon, hát nincs eldugott áru, hát nézzenek meg, de igen, valahol van, hol van, rendőrség. És azt mondta a rendőr, hogy mutassa meg, mert különben leteszem a pisztolyomat, és megtalálom, hogy maguk fegyvert rejtegettek.
Luckily we had two dachshunds, and those could stay on a chair. But as soon as the rats were coming up, pretty soon the dachshunds started catching the rats. And it was almost funny because my mother was scared of them. So when she saw a rat, she screamed. And very quickly the dogs learned when my mother screams, there is a rat.
You had to go to vote like every 5 years, and the Communist Party received 99.9% of the votes, for instance. And if you didn't go to vote, then you got beaten up by dogs.
The first thing my mother said, none of this is important. The only thing which is important is that we are together and we are happy. And they never complained.
In the early 1950s, Piller's reputation as a coach grows, rivaling the earlier fame he had garnered as a fencer. His Hungarian Saber squad maintains its domination on the world stage.
Fencing technique, saber fencing, is like a pianist and a violinist. You must have absolute technique to get the song to be so melodic. In order to be a great, hear a great composition, you gotta have super technique. He said, Piller teaches unbelievable, unbelievable technique.
Well, I first met him when I started competitive fencing and I went up to Budapest.
I went over to the club and met George Piller for the first time. And he looked at me and he says, oh, okay. He says, one of my assistants will check you out. Well, at that time, I thought I was a superstar, which I wasn't. I was greatly insulted by the fact that he turned me over to one of his assistants. I never went back, okay? I went back to my master and I said, I don't think I want to really go to see George Pillar because after all, he sent me over to someone else and he didn't take the time to check out my talents.
He was very well known as the highest ranking person in fencing in Hungary in everything. In tactics, there's nobody even close.
Az öreg hogy küldött fel valakit a zasszóra? Sorsdöntő küzdelem. Fölmész a pástra, megtolod, meghúzod, és utána a fejbe vágod. Ezt megcsinálod háromszor. És ha még nem győztél, akkor kezdj el vívni.
He couldn't stand it anymore, and then he said something Hungarian to the fencer, hit him on the head, because it was so obvious to him what you have to do.
What you have to do if someone really hits you hard, you have to give him a punitive cut. And I said, what is a punitive cut? Just hit him on the knee. He said, it will really hurt. He will not hit hard anymore.
Gerevich used to go to him a lot. Judy Bacci, what should I do with this or that? Because he had no tactical sense at all.
I understand that there was a very important championships where his pupil, being already a coach, his next match of his pupil was against Mr. Gerevich, who was a very, very prominent Hungarian fencer, and they thought that they are going to outsmart him. So Mr. Pillar, knowing that Mr. Gerevich went into the dressing room where there were the heads, took his pupil into the dressing room and acting like he didn't know that Gerevich was already in there, told his pupil that, you know, you are going to fix this Gerevich and I studied him and the only thing what you have to do that you are going to push him at the end of the step, show him a strong head feint, he is going to go up there and immediately when he does, you cut him in the flank, okay? Simple, and trust me, and you do this because I'm telling you to do that. And Gerevich was smacking his chops on I have him, and the story says this happened 3 times in the most important bout. Gerevich went up to quint, went down to quart, defending his stomach 3 times, but the guy didn't cut, he cut his head again. By the time he realized that there is something wrong, the bout was over.
His main effort was working with the squad at the training camps and going to competitions.
The psychology of the last touch is always very important. That's where later on Pillar have been very helpful to me in saying that you have to move on the pist that you are someone.
It was called a strategy session when he made two of his pupils fence with each other and they're commenting on their strategy and style. We learned a lot.
The reason the Hungarian fencers were so good and universally so good. It wasn't just one or two of them. All of them were at the absolute pinnacle of the sport. It was all the result of coaching.
But without working with a great master, a great coach, you'll never reach greatness, no matter how talented you are.
If you're a top competitor, you can hand on some of the tricks of the game, but the actual business of bringing on a young fencer involves almost having to unlearn what made you such a good competitive fencer. Really, you have to fight against the instincts you spent part of a lifetime learning in order to give the right conditions for your pupil to learn a particular move. You have to unlearn what made you a champion in order to be a champion coach. And Pillar is really unusual in having done that.
Hát amíg ő volt a szövetségi kapitány, a magyar válogatottat senki nem tudta legyőzni.
Recognizing Hungary's success in the sport, the Soviet Union decided to create their own cadre of fencing champions. In 1953, they summoned Hungary's best coaches and fencers to Moscow to teach the Hungarian methodology. Hungary had little say in the matter. Pillar and the others did as they were told. The wins for Hungary's saber team continued to mount. Pál Kovács won the 1952 Olympics and 1953 World Championship. Rudolf Karpaty won the Worlds in 1954. In this 3-year stretch, the Hungarians won not only the team gold, but took home gold, silver, and bronze in the individual events as well. In 1955, 45-year-old Aladar Garevich wins his last individual world championship, but retains his place on the national team for an additional 5 years. Expectations of success were understandably high as the team prepared for the 1956 Olympics in Melbourne, Australia.
I mean, remember, a revolution never starts with a rainy day. It has to be a nice day. A revolution almost started, broke out 2 weeks before the Reich, the former Prime Minister, Minister of Interior, was reburied. He was killed by the communists, but it was a pouring rainy day, and the crowd disappeared and went home.
Október 23-án az egyik jó barátommal jöttem hazafelé.
We all were in a training camp in Tata. We were following the events. We were confused what was going on.
I met Tom Orley. He came to my college, so I asked him about the Hungarian Revolution, and he told me he got shot at, and he was throwing rocks at tanks, and I don't know what else.
We were students at the Pharmacological University, and I was late, and I was going into the university, and they told me that there is going to be a demonstration.
I heard that something is planned by the university.
A fő cél az volt akkor Ruszkik haza.
I went to this particular square where it actually started, and it so happened that that square in one of the apartment buildings had a friend's family living. So I called him up and I said, can I go up and watch what's going on from the window, which I did when the university crowd arrived. And about 10 minutes later, I was down there too.
The first morning when we woke up, there were shootings all over the place. We went outside and we saw people, dead people, on the street. And as a matter of fact, I saw some of the kids who used to be in the junior high school with me. A couple of kids, I remember seeing them dead.
And the radio station was obviously occupied by the government's secret service, at which point they were shooting into the crowd because they were afraid that the crowd is going to run them out of it.
That's where they ripped out the red star from the flag.
És a trollival jöttünk, Kispesten volt a gyár, és jöttünk haza. A trollibusszal jöttünk el a Stalin szobornál, és rengeteg ember gyülekezett ott.
So I took the underground and went out and happened to see when the huge statue was cut at the boots.
A Stalin szobrot ledöntöttük, ott segítettünk kötéllel húzni teherautóval, nem tudom mivel, és ott eltört a csizmájánál.
Somebody said that the workers from Chapel, where they had munition factories, had ammunition, but they didn't have the weapons. But in a university we had submachine guns, heavy machine guns, and I said to these guys, okay, I know where weapons are.
We went over to the parliament and demanded a change. And Imre Nagy, who became later the prime minister and was hanged, he came out and started to address the crowd that, hey, comrades. And then we started shouting, we are not comrades, we are Hungarian.
Harc, a szovjet csapatok ugye itt voltak, mindjárt megjelentek, és akkor úgy volt majdnem, hogy egy nap harc, egy nap felvonulás, másik nap megint harc, utána megint felvonulás. A vége felé aztán a felvonulás elmaradt, akkor már csak harc volt.
Some left the training camp, went up to Budapest, and facing the Russian tanks. Most of us stayed in the background and was hoping for the best.
Valószínűleg végül mindenki úgy döntött, hogy hát fölkészültünk, elmegyünk, és így képviseljük a hazánkat.
Nagyon érdekes, hogy Magyarországon is kevesen tudják, hogy három olyan európai nemzet bojkottálta az olimpiát, és nem vett részt Melbourne-be budapesti események miatt. Nem voltak ott a spanyolok, a svájciak, a hollandok.
The question was that obviously, is there going to be an Olympics or not?
Nagyon hosszú ideig úgy látszott, hogy nem akarnak kimenni. Tehát az a döntés nem csak politikailag, hanem a csapat tagjai részéről is, hogy nem hagyják el Budapestet.
That's a mystery how
we managed to get out of Hungary in spite of those fantastic events which took place.
Rendkívül nehéz volt megszervezni, egyáltalán fizikálisan eljussanak Melbourne-ig.
Hungary had a deal with Air France to take the team with two planes to Melbourne.
Az a francia légitársaság, amelyik szállította volna a csapatot, már nem volt hajlandó Budapestre leszállni.
The team left Budapest early in the morning, three or four buses to Komárom. The Czech were really scared that the revolution will go over them.
Tehát el kellett jutniuk Prágáig. Visszaszálltak a buszaikba, és elmentek Komáromig, ahol is gyalogkeltek át a hídon csomagokkal. Átmentek a hídon, és Komárnóból, tehát a másik oldali Komáromból mentek el végül is vonattal Prágáig.
And we waited for the French plane to arrive and take us to Melbourne.
Napokig várakoztak Prágában, Prága mellett a Nymburki edzőtáborban. Egyre kínosabbá váltak a csehszlovákok számára. A probléma az volt, hogy nem volt kifizetve a repülő. Tehát a franciák addig nem vitték őket onnan se el, amíg kifizetik az utat. Úgyhogy a csehszlovák állam és a kinti táborbeli nagykövetségek dobták össze a pénzt, csak menjenek már onnan.
Before we left, the streets in Budapest was full of people hugging each other. It was an unbelievable feeling.
So I made an agreement with my wife that if the situation is really became unbearable, I would have probably escaped.
Tehát két különböző útvonalon, két gép egy hét alatt vitt el őket Melbourne.
When we left, it was still possible that the revolution could have won.
Végig gond volt egyébként az úton, hogy nem tudták, hogy mi van itt. Tehát rémhírek terjedtek.
I'm not exactly sure at what point did we finally hear the news that the Russians came back.
We decided to go out and hoping revolution would win and we come back, but didn't turn out that way.
Tehát egy rendkívül fáradt, pszichésen meggyötört, bizonytalan társaság érkezett Melbournebe, azzal együtt, hogy egyértelműen a legjobban fölkészített és a legjobb magyar csapat volt ez, olimpiai csapat volt ez. Normál körülmények között biztosan túlhaladták volna a legsikeresebb Helsinki olimpia eredményeit.
George Taylor came over here in 1956. He was in Australia where they were winning the Olympics. When the Russians started blowing Budapest down, that was the 56ers when the Hungarian Revolution went down against the Russians, and they just moved tanks in and just blew the city down block after block until the resistance was over. See, while the athletes were in Melbourne, a lot of them expatriated in this country instead of going back.
On November the 4th, they decided to crush the whole thing. It was really bad.
And then when I heard the news that the Russians came in, it was really a tragedy for us, and we got utterly confused what to do.
I was down a couple of days later in the city, walking down, you know. It was tough. It was really, really tough. So when I left Budapest, it was in ruins.
So we decided that we are going to not quit the Olympics, but in the beginning when you have the march, we are not going to wear the communist emblem, but we wore the new Hungarian emblem with the black ribbon across.
Aki nem tudta elvinni, tehát nem tudott hazamenni a ruhájáért, annak Melbourne-ben konfekció ruhát vásároltak, hogy valamennyire egységes kinézettel tudjon fölvonulni a csapat. Tehát a sötétebb egyenruha, ami látszik a külön blokkba, a fölvonuló csapatba, az valamelyik nagy áruházból került elő, ott kint helyszínen vásárolták.
It was a brutal Olympic Games between Hungary and the Soviet Union. Even in swimming, in water polo, nothing but blood in the water. In water polo, the Hungarians, the Soviet Union, blood.
Despite the turmoil back home, Piller coached the Saber squad to another team gold, and Rudolf Carpetti captured the individual gold medal.
It's a very difficult thing when you leave your country and you know you are going to go back, and now you are out in Australia and you don't really know what happened.
Hungary had a very large team, like 120 or more, and 42 or 43 of them decided not to go home.
They thought maybe we can get the families out, but they couldn't get in contact with anybody.
And the Soviet Union in those years kidnapped several people in Australia. And we could not leave the camp, the Olympic camp, until the Soviet ship left.
It was a very difficult decision to make.
We talked to each other, and well, actually even Kovács wanted to stay out.
And the decision what we made turned out to be correct.
We went out to the airport. It still occurred to me that maybe I should get on the plane.
It was much more easier for us to decide not to go back than to the senior fencers.
They could understand why we stayed. We could understand why they went back. So there was no animosity at all.
De mivel ez a fiatal csapat mind kidisszidált, mind kimentek, kimaradtak az olimpia után, ezért muszáj volt, hogy valahogy ezért még 4 évet tovább vívtak az öregek, ezért...
It wasn't just the Olympic athletes who defected. During a brief window of opportunity, hundreds of thousands of Hungarians fled the country by whatever means they could. Among these refugees were fencers George Domolki, Alex Orban, Janos Mohos, and Csaba Gall.
The Russian tanks were already shelling the city and moving from avenue to avenue, and we were actually moving ahead of them.
Frankly, I wanted no part of getting out of there because my idea was to be a fencing superstar.
És december 12-én ugye felállították a statáriális rögtönítélő bíróságokat, és akkor mondtam a szüleimnek, hogy itt nem lesz bal, nincs mese. Ha én egy élni akarok, kettő egyetemre szeretnék járni, meg egyáltalán a kedvenc sportágamban valamit akarok, akkor nekem ki kell menni nyugatra, kész. És akkor nagy nehezen, nagy nehézségek árán, de ügyesen, ravaszul kijutottam.
And if you did not make it before they control the media, the telephones, the communication, the radios, you would not have gotten out.
I wanted to go to the railroad station and take a train toward the border. And there was this Russian guard there checking IDs. And I knew that they are looking for railroad workers because the rails were destroyed. So I said to this Russian guy in Russian, "Tovarish, ya som zhelezno dorozhnik," which means I'm a railroad worker. And he let me through. We went to the border. It was pretty hairy and pretty difficult.
If he did not make it during those couple of days, he would have never gotten out.
And there was statarium. Statarium means that the government said that after 6 o'clock, the people are being shot without questions asked who are on the street.
Well, I was kind of worried about my sister being safe, leaving the country and coming across the border because some people did get shot, you know, and some people got captured and so on and so forth. So I was kind of worried about it, and I decided that I just got to go with her.
This peasant family, the following morning, took us out toward the border, and they said, "There is the West."
All of a sudden, out of the forest comes two border policemen with big German shepherds. And the one of the woodcutters said, "Well, you guys were really unlucky."
When we arrived, we hoped that to Austria, because they even, I understand, they even made tricks. But picking up and putting the flags down, although they're still on the Hungarian side, just to fool the people.
Once we got across the border, we didn't know whether we were in Austria or Hungary, but we found a chocolate wrapper on the floor, and it was German, so we figured we are in Austria.
And we knew that there was a no man's land. We even knew that the no man's land sometimes are they put the mines there, and they have some, they had machine gun towers and stuff like this. So when we got there, we started to run.
I had to get through a landmine, and there was a river which I had to go through, and then I was in Austria. And it was a magnificent feeling to be in a free country.
For many, the decision to leave Hungary was an easy one. But George Pillar was faced with the difficult choice of leaving the country he loved, a country to which he had devoted his life, for an unknown future.
I don't think he regretted it because he disliked so much the system there.
But he was pretty sure he doesn't want to go back.
That since the Russians came back and they broke the revolution, I felt that he just decided that that's not the kind of life that he wants to live in.
You're going to take everything that I existed for, everything that I believed in, and now you're telling me that you're in charge of everything that I existed for? I cannot live under those conditions.
Ami szerintem nagyon fontos, hogy az Egyesült Államok való távozása után sem szakította meg a kapcsolatot az ő magyar barátaival, akik itthon maradtak, vívótársaival, rendszeresen levelezett velük.
Hát ott voltunk Melbourne-be, és ott a segítségünkre jött a Sports Illustrated magazin, akik felajánlották, hogy szponzorolnak minket egy amerikai utazásra.
We know what sponsors said that was all about.
We got the best plane, what Pan Am had at that time, with sleeping compartments, champagne.
Downstairs was the dining room, and there we played bridge with Pillar and with the rest of the trip. Upstairs, every evening, the stewardesses made a bed for my wife, first class food, so the cockpit was open and I was in the cockpit. And we flew over the Golden Gate Bridge.
We ended up in Mark Hopkins. It was Christmas Day when we arrived.
17th floor, overlooking the Golden Gate Bridge.
And when I got to America, that was the time they had this Hungarian athletes freedom tour.
Towards the end, we were told that that tour is being planned for us. It's a great experience for us. I mean, touring the country.
You know, I mean, we were treated as royalties everywhere.
It was a wonderful experience to know the generosity of the American people who were very involved in the braveness of the Hungarians. We were on the Ed Sullivan show and we did this for 2 or 3 months.
When we started out, we were just fencing with the Vikings. I think it was Hammer's idea that maybe we should do a Hollywood fencing.
They did fencing, but they did cowboy fencing, wearing cowboy hats.
They fought up and down stairways and up the bleachers and down the bleachers, and it was, they had a great time.
We tried to put in a little panache.
Hammery and one of the gymnasts, they are married. Hammery has to leave.
Greta Korondi, the gymnast, was kissing with another Hungarian.
I sit down, she sits on my lap. First she dances around a little.
And the husband, I think it was me, who was swinging down on the ropes like a Tarzan.
With the saber in his mouth.
Then started a duel.
All the other fencers, Šaković and Rerich and all these others, come out. Hammery had to fence against 6 people.
It was quite a successful story of mass dueling.
At the very end, I fall down and he comes, he's going to kill me. And I shoot him with a revolver.
We really enjoyed that, going from place to place and having demonstrations.
Stopping in San Francisco was sort of important because everybody had to decide, now what do you next? Well, San Francisco was like heaven.
One of the main reasons he stayed in the West Coast because after 25 years, he has such a happy memories of the Los Angeles Olympics.
And I think it was Pillar's trip to San Francisco at that time that convinced him that that was where he wanted to live.
The valuable was, how does the team stay here?
He loved the temperature. He loved the Marina district. And he loved his Pontiac.
In 1956, when the Hungarians left Melbourne and came, many of them came to the San Francisco Bay Area. I was 8 years old. And they formed a club.
Obviously, the reason I went to San Francisco because of George Pillar. And the Pannonia Club was the club.
So when we stayed here, we formed the Pannonia Athletic Club, which was in a Polk Street in a German house.
It was in the attic space of this old building in San Francisco, and it was cold. And so some of the Americans who fenced there called it the Pneumonia Club.
And I think you know Pannonia was the name of the Hungarian province under the Romans.
There was a lot of being together, worrying together, laughing together, like strong ties, playing cards together. That was the Pannonia Club.
We also had some very, very strong table tennis matches because George Pillar loved table tennis.
So it really was a club that was founded by the fencers to be a fencing club, but was far more than just a fencing club.
Here was George Pillar, the internationally renowned saber fencer and coach, and Jack Baker, the Pacific Coast champion, was across from him, all in fencing stuff. And the way Charlie put it is, Pillar said, "Mr. Baker, when you're ready, straight cut to head." And Jack Baker apparently had a remarkably good flesh. But as he started the flesh, Pillar reached out, and depending how much Charlie was exaggerating, cut him on the inside of the hand, cut him on the outside of the hand, maybe cut him a few more times, but then finished by parrying the cut to head and doing a belly riposte. And Charlie says, "At that moment, I knew I needed to relearn everything I knew about sabering."
Well, I was kind of scared, to tell you the truth. So when it was my turn, he took me over to the strip and introduced me to George Pillar. I wanted to get something going, kind of, so I said, "How shall I address you?" He turned to Magai and said something in Hungarian, and then he turned back to me and said, "In the lesson, I am Maestro. The rest of the time, call me Uncle George." And that about blew my mind, because I fenced with several different fencing masters, and none of them told me to call him Uncle anything. The Pillar really did have those two roles. He was the master in the lesson, and he was your uncle.
In Hungary, it was György bácsi, and here it was Uncle George.
Very frankly, I don't think he liked living here. He was not cherished as he was in Hungary.
But he wasn't the person who would let you know how he feels. He was a military man. That's his job. He's doing it.
He came to America, and he became just a coach. 99.9% of the Americans, they had no idea who George Pillar was.
He liked it here, boy. He was really happy to be here. Really, really happy, even though his life was way harder.
Although living and working in near obscurity, Pillar's new team at the Pannonia Athletic Club quickly established itself as a powerhouse on the U.S. fencing scene.
And they're at Pannonia Athletic Club at a Saber Open, and the first round had gone through, and the Saber boys that were under, the Hungarian boys that were under Pillar's still tutelage, had essentially, you know, mopped up the field. But that over in the corner, they were all gathered around Pillar, who the image that Charlie had was Pillar was sitting down, and he was clearly not happy with how they had fenced, even though they'd all gone undefeated except maybe against each other. And he was really reading them the riot act. Sort of the Hungarian speakers kind of sidles over to eavesdrop, trying to be like surreptitious about it, and then came back and said, "He's yelling at them because he said they could only attack head in the first round, and some of them made feint attacks."
This first team consisted of Dan Magai, Olympic gold medalist from the 1956 squad, Tom Orley, the 1954 junior world champion, and George Domolke, who had trained alongside Dan and Tom prior to the Olympics.
George Pillar said, "We should enter this tournament." I said, "Well, what are our chances?" And he said, "Don't worry." And so we went to Milwaukee, the three of us, and I think we won the championship. We beat the New York Athletic Club.
We decided after the competition that we would sell our, at those days you could do it, sell the airplane tickets back and buy a car.
There were several issues with this car. One was that, was it okay to sell the ticket and buy a car?
Nobody had a driver's license.
That was the time we really got very close to George Piller.
Piller sat in the front seat next to the driver.
Piller didn't drive, so he just gave instructions.
It took 2 days, or at least 2 days.
The car broke down at some point. Piller, being a colonel in the army, doesn't seem to know too much about cars, but he looked at the engine and he said, the engine is too hot, what we have to do is to get a water bottle and put it outside, that will cool the car off and it will hopefully take us back to California.
At the end we arrived to Berkeley and then we decided we are going to pull who is going to have the car. So we put the names down and I got the car.
As we approached his house, I think in an intersection we touched a Mercedes, a brand new Mercedes. And I don't think we had insurance. This trip back is just reinforced my liking of him.
Pannonia was, for the first couple of years while I was there, was a national saber team champion. We came to New York and we won the national championship twice with the Pannonia.
It was probably the strongest saber club in the United States at that time.
We'll never know how long the Pannonia Athletic Club might have dominated saber fencing in the U.S., as George Piller's life took one final dramatic turn.
Somebody said, Uncle George has throat cancer, cancer of the tongue, actually, I think. And then the next time I saw him, he had the big X's on his neck.
That moment that was captured, Charlie's winning at the Pacific Coast Championships and George being there to congratulate him, it meant a lot.
He was a chain smoker, he's a military man, that's what they did. Played cards, smoked, drank.
He couldn't kick the habit, unfortunately.
And it wasn't that obvious at his time that smoking causes cancer.
You know, I know he smoked a lot of cigarettes, and he smoked them down in the garage because Baba wouldn't let him in the house with a cigarette.
Cut his tongue off. And he learned to speak without a tongue.
I was very sad because he was only 60 years old. It was a kind of story that you just hope that he'll get better, but it didn't work out that way.
His daughter, Hoina, had made enough money by dancing to go to Germany and treat him.
A németeknek volt egy kiváló tőrvívója és kardvívója. Ez jó barátja volt a Jekelfalussy Pillernek. És a lányával Amerikából ehhez az illetőhöz ment, aki egy gazdag német volt, hogy segítsen neki a torok nyelv rákjába. És ez segített neki, végigjárták az összes német professzort, kórházat, mindent, hogy ki tud segíteni rajta, és senki nem tudott. Hát ezen.
But when he came back from Germany, he was really frail, he was really exhausted, he lost a lot of weight, and his chin, he started to kind of dissolve.
When he found out later that the cancer came back and there is nothing they can do, that's the only time I saw him cry.
You know, he took about 6 or 8 months and he was gone. You know?
If he wouldn't have had this sudden death, he could have continued to teach and make many new champions.
Amikor nagyon beteg vagy, és már nincs esély arra, hogy meggyógyulj, akkor sem hagyod el a pástot. Ez az egyik legfontosabb, amit tudni kell. Amikor rákos lett a Piller, Az egy olyan fájdalommal járó dolog, amikor kivágják a nyelvedet, amikor kivágják a fél torkodat, amikor megtanulsz nyelv nélkül beszélni. De nem hagyta el a vívóiskoláját, nem hagyta el a tanítványait. Nekem ez az egyik legfontosabb üzenet, hogy amíg élsz, fogod a kardodat, és tanítasz, és küzdesz, és bármi is lesz, az utolsó napokig ott vagy velük. Akkor is, ha elvesztetted a hazádat, akkor is elvesztettél mindent.
A római olimpia alatt írt egy gyönyörű levelet, hogy sajnos már nem tudja a hazáját szolgálni, de reméli, hogy Rómába is a magyar kard diadalmaskodik. És meg is nyertük a csapatot és az egyénit is. De már halálán volt, mikor, sőt, diktálta a levelet a Hajninak, a lányának.
My beloved fencing friends, I am with you in my soul. With anxious worry, but at the same time with high hopes, I fight through this last Olympics of my life. I'm sorry I could not be there in Rome like I planned, because my terrible illness prevents it. This fight is very sad because there can't be any doubt how it will end. I can only be the loser. I leave the fencing strip forever. I won't see you again, with whom so many memories, so many fights forged us into one. I beseech you to preserve me in your memories. If life after the grave is true, then I won't stop loving you, and Hungarian fencing, and my home country. May God bless all of you. Your loving Uncle George.
When George died, the whole fencing community mourned.
Probably one of the saddest things that we experienced. We came here.
I saw him the night before he died. I was there, and he had like a gaping hole in his chin and his jaw, and he was kind of putting the tampon on it and the tape, and he tried to relieve the pain, and he was praying to die. He was in such an agony, so he was praying to die. And that was around 12 o'clock that night, and I got the call at 7 o'clock in the morning that he died. So he knew the end was coming, and he went. I got very emotional. Anyway, I miss him.
Piller was just 61 years old when he died, yet the impact of his coaching and the lessons he conveyed to his students and other masters reverberates to this day. Dan Magai was the U.S. national champion three times. Tom Orley was the 1959 U.S. national champion and a member of the 1964 U.S. Olympic Sabre team. Eugene Hamery twice won the U.S. national championship and was also a member of the 1964 Olympic team. Alex Orban won the U.S. national sabre title five times and was a three-time Olympic team member. After Piller's death, Orban joined the Army, then settled in New York, where he was trained by Piller's coaching protege, Chaba Eltish. Eltish was the dean of American saber fencing for three decades. His most decorated student was Peter Westbrook.
What makes our organization great is I learned from my coach Chaba, and I learned what he told me about Piller. And that is this: you can create a person to be a great fencer, but if you show him how to be a great man and you put the two together, you have a superior product. And that's what we do at the Peter Westbrook Foundation. So I thank George, I thank my coach Chaba, of course. I'm learning from Piller. to don't just teach them fencing, show them how to give of yourself what he gave, his love, his dedication, all that he has, he wanted to share with my coach. My coach wanted to share that with me, and I'm learning from the both of them how to share this greatness to make our kids great.
Westbrook was U.S. national champion 13 times, named to 6 Olympic teams, and won the individual bronze medal at the 1984 Olympic Games. He now heads the Peter Westbrook Foundation, where a new generation of fencers are achieving Olympic success.
Illetve, hát amikor az Egyesült Államokba kerül, akkor pedig ott az amerikaiaknak adja át ezeket a módszereket. Tehát a borsodi módszer az rajta keresztül az Egyesült Államokba is elkerül.
Which brings us back to Charles Selberg and his good friend, John McDougall.
I was at my cell on Clement Street, and the phone rang, and Uncle George said, "This is Uncle George, John." He said, "I've been thinking." He said, I have this disease. I'm sick with cancer." And I don't know that he really mentioned that, but that was in there, you know. And he said, "I would really like to have some Americans that know how to teach my kind of saber, and I invite you and Charlie to come down in the morning twice a week, and I will show you how to teach Hungarian saber." And that was the best deal anybody ever offered me in my life. I mean, it was free too, you know. I really should have paid him, but I was teaching fencing for a living, so it was hard to do. But anyway, that's how that started. And I thought, "Uncle George, I will be there. Will you tell me when?" You know, I didn't have to ask Charlie. I knew he'd go.
Magyarországon az emberek többsége nagyon szerette a sportot, és ugye ismeretes, hogy 1908-tól gyakorlatilag 1964-ig kardvívásban egy-egy alkalmat leszámítva mindig Magyarország nyerte az egyéni és a csapatversenyt is. És a nagy sportolókra az emberek egy része mindig szívesen emlékezik vissza, és én azt gondolom, hogy ez az oka annak, hogy Piller György neve továbbra is fönt marad és gondolnak rá. Tehát én azt gondolom, hogy ennek ez lehet az oka, hiszen ha belegondolunk, az én ismereteim szerint ugye Piller György meghalt, felesége meghalt, lánya szintén tragikus sorsot ért meg, tehát nem a család ápolja ilyen értelemben közvetlenül az ő emlékét, hanem a magyar sporttársadalom. Ez nem jelenti azt, hogy 10 millió ember tudja, ki volt Piller György, vagy Jekelfalussy György, meg hogy testőrtiszt volt, meg mikor végzett, de az olimpiai bajnokok között, ha megemlítik a nevét, akkor biztos, hogy tudják, hogy kiről van szó.